Good morning and welcome to Melbourne Baptist Church Online. My name is Reverend David Clarke and I'm saying hi to our regular members but also to any of you who are visiting us for the first time. Please go to our website www.melbournebaptistchurch.org.uk to see how you can connect with our church community. We're going to sing our first song this morning, Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven. Testament reading today is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 6. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and exalted, seated on a throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him were seraphim, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying. And they were calling to one another, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory. At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and threshold shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. Woe to me, I cried, I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. And my eyes have seen the Lord Almighty. Then one of the seraphim flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongues from the altar. With it he touched my mouth and said, See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for. Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, Whom shall I send and who will go for us? And I said, Here am I, send me. I'm going to sing again, Here I am, Lord.
Shall I send? Here I am.
Say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Let us sing again, "You're the Word of God the Father."
You're the Word of God the Father, from before the world began. Every star and every planet has been fashioned by your hand. All creation holds together by the power of your voice. Let the skies declare your glory, let the land and seas rejoice. You're the author of creation, you're the Lord of every man, and your cry of love rings out across the land. Yet you left the gaze of angels, came to see and save the lost, and exchange the joy of heaven for the anguish of the cross. With a prayer you fed the hungry, with a word you stilled the sea. Yet how silently you suffered, that the guilty may go free. You're the author of creation, you're the Lord, every man, and your cry of love and ascended into heaven, leading captives in your way. Now you stand before the Father, interceding for your own. From each tribe and tongue and nation, you are leading sinners home. You're the author of creation, you're the Lord of every man, and your cry
New Testament reading is taken from Matthew 10. Jesus called his 12 disciples to him and gave them authority to drive out impure spirits and to heal every disease and sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, who is called Peter, and his brother Andrew, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew the tax collector, James son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the Zealot and Judas Iscariot who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Do not go among the Gentiles or enter any town of the Samaritans. Go rather to the lost sheep of Israel. As you go, proclaim this message. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons. Freely you have received, freely give. Do not get any gold or silver or copper to take with you in your belts. No bag for the journey or extra shirt or sandals or a staff, for the worker is worth his keep. Whatever town or village you enter, search there for some worthy person and stay at their house until you leave. As you enter the home, give it your greeting. If the home is deserving, let your peace rest on it. If it is not, let your peace return to you. If anyone will not welcome you or listen to your words, leave that home or town and shake the dust off your feet. Truly I tell you, it will be more bearable for Sodom and Gomorrah on the day of judgment than that for that town. I am sending you like sheep among wolves. Therefore be as shrewd as snakes and as innocent as doves. Be on your guard. You will be handed over to the local councils and be flogged in the synagogues. On my account, you will be brought before governors and kings as witnesses to them and to the Gentiles. But when they arrest you, do not worry about what to say or how to say it. At that time, you will be given what to say. For it will not be you speaking, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Let's pray. Lord, I pray your Holy Spirit would speak through me, Lord, today as I bring your word to your people. Amen. I remember at the end of my university degree, I had the opportunity to do another year of engineering study on a master's program. But after not much thought, I decided that I really had had enough of sitting in lectures and listening to someone drone on, and that I really wanted to get out into the wide world and put into practice what I'd learnt. And I wonder if the disciples felt a little like that. They'd been following Jesus around for quite a while, listening to his teaching and seeing him heal the sick, and wondering, is he going to let us have a go? He's been telling us to have faith and to ask for anything in his name. Maybe we can do this too. I guess their expectations rose all the more when they saw Jesus' compassion for the crowds which were flocking to him, and he said to these same disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest fields." In this chapter, we see how Jesus organizes his disciples for kingdom mission, and we're going to use it as our model for mission today. There are many similarities to Luke chapter 10 and the sending of the 72. You may remember the Luke 10 T-series that we looked at 2 years ago. So what are we to learn about mission from this chapter? Well, I think the first thing is to see the harvest with Jesus' eyes of compassion. Kingdom mission begins with seeing our communities as God's harvest fields. As we pray and ask God to send our workers into his harvest field, it assumes, as did Jesus, that God will call us to be part of the answer to our own prayers, to be those very kingdom workers. I was listening to an evangelist, and he said much of the church in the United Kingdom has a barn focus and not a harvest field focus. We're rather like farm workers who build great barns, and we paint and polish the barns, and we sit in them and wait for the harvest to gather itself. We need good barns, else the harvest will rot. But unless it's gathered, it'll rot in the fields. We need a field focus. We all need to get out together and gather. One of the temptations of this COVID crisis is to see it as a great restriction on church life. We can't do many of the programs that we're used to be doing. I think we need to look realistically at many of the mission programs that we had and think they're really more in drag than outreach. We're expecting people to come to us rather than to go to them. I think COVID has given us the opportunity to look to the needs of our neighbours and to think, how can we reach them? How can we go to them? How can we fulfil their needs? Secondly, we should use our gatherings for equipping. Having said that we need to look outwards, the first thing Jesus did was to gather his disciples together. And in this gathering, he gave them his authority for mission, to heal and to deliver. And we've looked at that recently. And here he gives them his instructions on how to carry out their mission. As Baptists, we are proud to describe ourselves as the gathered church. And we've put a lot of effort into maintaining that gathering during lockdown, albeit on Zoom. And now we're working really hard to reopen the church building. But we are not to see this gathering as an end in itself. There are a number of purposes for the church to gather together, including prayer and worship and fellowship and encouragement and teaching. But one key reason must be for the equipping and encouragement of mission. One way of seeing this gathering is rather like the pre-match talk given by the coach prior to the big match. Ian Sim, a previous moderator of this church, said to me, as I started, he said, don't use football analogies, they just don't get them in Malvern. Well, I'm going to use an analogy anyway, but think about it as the coach giving a talk to a rugby team or a football team or a hockey team. The coach explains the tactics and he motivates and encourages. But prior to them going out on the field to play their part in the team efforts, and you could see me as pastor, as the head coach, along with other coaching staff, training and motivating you for kingdom mission in our community mission fields. Thirdly, we should go where Jesus sends us. Jesus in verses 5 to 6 tells the 12 to go to the lost sheep of Israel to continue his mission. And later, notably Matthew 28, he tells his disciples to go into all the world. In Acts, Philip is told by the Holy Spirit to run by the Ethiopian's chariot. And Paul is prevented by the Spirit of Jesus from entering Bithynia and instead called to in a vision to Macedonia. The point is that we all have a general commission to go into all the world. But in that we should listen to Jesus directing us by his Spirit to the places and people and opportunities that he desires. And that requires a growing relationship with him in prayer and a willingness to obey the promptings of his Spirit. Fourthly, we should build relationships with those we meet living an authentic Christian lifestyle. It says in verse 11, whatever town or village you enter, search there for some worthy person and stay at their house until you leave. Jesus tells his mission teams to seek out a welcoming person who will give them hospitality. Luke calls them the person of peace. And in our context, we should seek out, with God's help, people we can build relationships with. People are far more likely to listen to us and what we have to say if they know us and trust us and can see that our Christian lives are lived authentically, that we practice what we preach. Fifthly, we should go with a blessing. As you enter the home, it says, give it your greeting. If the home is deserving, let your peace rest on it. If it is not, let your peace return to you. The greeting of Jesus' day was Shalom, peace be with you. And I encourage you to pray God's blessing and peace on every place and situation that you go into during your day and upon every person that you meet. This is an approach commended by Ray Godwin and Feldy Brennan. And I have a copy of his book, The Grace Outpouring, and another, The Way of Blessing. And you can have one of these if you give me a ring. But as we bless people, we could use the BLESS acronym. You can pray for a person by asking the Lord to bless the person's body. Pray for health and protection and strength. L, labour. Pray for their work and their income and their security. E, their emotions. For joy and peace and hope and love. For S, social relationships. Pray that that person's marriage be blessed and their family relationships and their friends and their neighbours and their colleagues. And another S, spiritual relationship. Pray for their salvation and their faith and their grace and their mercy and spiritual growth in them. Pray a blessing upon them. And our aim in blessing is to bathe our spiritual environment in prayer and to change the spiritual atmosphere, to release God's blessing into our communities. Sixthly, we should proclaim the message of the kingdom. As you go, proclaim this message: the kingdom of heaven has come near. We should take every opportunity to tell people about Jesus and how God wants to break into their lives. How we present that message, how we adjust the specific content of our message will depend on the person we're talking to and the circumstances we're in. But we have a gospel to proclaim it, and we should proclaim it. As I said many times before, if you're not getting many opportunities, pray this prayer: Lord, give me an opportunity to share about you or to show your love to someone today. Amen. I guarantee that God will answer that prayer. And if he doesn't, you can come back to me and I'll give you your money back. I remember a power of personal testimony. If you can't remember all the verses, the Bible verses like John 16 and Romans 5:8 and Romans 2 verse 23, if you can't remember all those, just ask people what they believe and then tell them what you believe and what Jesus has done for you. Have a go. God will bless you. Seventhly, we should demonstrate God's kingdom by responding to the immediate needs of others. Jesus said, heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons. Freely you have received, freely give. Jesus told his disciples to demonstrate the power of the inbreaking kingdom of heaven by healing and deliverance, and describing this as an act of spiritual generosity. Maybe your faith isn't up to praying for the dead yet, but you have been saved, you've been healed, you've been delivered. Offer the same to others. We can demonstrate the inbreaking kingdom of heaven by responding to the immediate needs of the people we meet, practically and or in prayer, offering to pray with people when prompted by the Holy Spirit. It can be prayer for healing, but it can simply be offering that there's been shopping for someone who's not well. But let's demonstrate God's kingdom by meeting people's needs. And eighthly, we should carry out Jesus' mission, whatever the cost. In verse 16 onwards, Jesus anticipates future missions and warns his disciples that they will face opposition and persecution for carrying out his mission. He says, you'll be flogged, arrested, betrayed by family members, hated and hounded. But faced with this persecution, Jesus says, therefore be as shrewd as snakes and as innocent as doves. Don't court opposition unnecessarily when you are opposed, but do not worry about what to say or how to say it. At that time, you will be given what to say, for it will not be you speaking, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. And don't be afraid of those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. If we are faithful in sharing our faith, even in this country, we will be opposed. And if we are, we should continue to share anyway. And when we do that, the Holy Spirit will empower us. Indeed, will give us the very words to say. So a recap for my conclusion. We should see the harvest with God, Jesus' eyes of compassion. We should use our gatherings for equipping for mission. We should go where Jesus sends us. We should build relationships with those who meet, living an authentic Christian lifestyle. We should go with a blessing. We should proclaim the message of the kingdom. We should demonstrate God's kingdom by responding to the immediate needs of others, and we should carry out Jesus' mission, whatever the cost. Mark Twain famously said, "It is not the parts of Jesus' teaching which I don't understand which bothers me, it's the parts I do understand." This is not difficult teaching to understand, but it is challenging, especially if we believe it applies to us as Jesus' disciples. Michael Green writes, "The best way to train people in mission is not to give eloquent addresses on the subject, but to get people out on the streets or into the houses and prisons. This is what Jesus did." I need to train you and not just talk at you. And to train you, I need to live a missionary life myself. I confess I need God's help to lead you in putting Jesus' mission into practice in Jesus' way. But with God's help, I will. Please pray for me in this. Let's pray. Lord, I ask for your help, Lord, to be a disciple and a missionary. Lord, I ask that for your help, Lord, in your spirit, that I might train your people, Lord, to reach out to our community your way. Fill us with your spirit, we pray. Amen. Let's sing our final song, "Tell Out My Soul."
Tell out my soul, the glory.
Jesus Christ, send us out with confidence in your word to tell the world of your saving acts and bring glory to your name. Amen.